Clark Railway Project, AC Energy's Climate Bond, and the EDSA Greenways Project. What do these three have in common? Well, they're all projects being supported by the Asian Development Bank. Now, earlier this week, the Multilateral Development Bank cut their growth forecast for developing Asia, including the Philippines. When does it see the local economy turning a corner? And how will the government's infra push help? Joining us this morning, ADB Philippines Country Manager Kelly Bird. Mr. Kelly, thank you so much for joining us. Great to have you this morning.
Thank you. You're welcome.
So let's start with the central bank. They cut rates as expected for a third time this year. Do you think that they're going to give more? Because apparently people want more, more and more.
Okay. Well, I think, you know, if you read our recent update, you know, we see the Philippine economy as being very resilient. Been resilient against you know, a very weak global environment. Our own forecasts, we've dropped our forecasts from 6.4 to 6%.
For
this year. But we're also projecting a pickup next year. And I think that will always hinge on the government recovering its expenditure, its public spending. But it also, there's also room for the central bank to reduce its interest rates, given that inflation is low. They did that yesterday. I think we need to now wait for the third quarter growth figures. We also need to see how some of the geopolitical events, how that feeds into domestic inflation before they consider another drop in interest rates. But I do think over the next 12 months, given that inflation is relatively low, there will be room to cut those interest rates.
Some more. You did lower your forecast for the Philippine economy to grow from 6.4 initial forecast to 6% this year. Even at that rate, you're still one of the more optimistic ones, because other economists are saying, you know, 6% for this year, it's forgone. It's not going to happen. Why are you optimistic?
Okay, we're optimistic in two ways. First of all, the slowdown in growth this year has been primarily because of a slowdown in public spending on infrastructure. Household consumption is holding up very well. In fact, for the first half of this year, it grew at 5.8%. Government consumption, a bit slower, but it was also reasonable. Where the slowdown occurred was in public construction, and that's where public spending on infrastructure dropped by 20%. And that was related to the delayed budget, passage of the budget. It was also because of the midterm elections. Government has the fiscal space. Their budget target this year is 3.2%. They probably won't make, 3.2% deficit. They probably won't make that. But if they do reverse their underspending for the second half of this year, we should see a strong pickup third and fourth quarter. So I think it'll be close to 6%. Next year's budget, the proposal is also to continue with a 3.2% budget deficit. That will keep the economy growing above 6%.
Okay, so going back to the global easing trend, it's clearly a global trend. You've got the implementation of quantitative easing, lower interest rates, negative interest rates at some point. These are starting to cause concern for fiscal instability and, of course, the flow of international capital. Is it starting to be a concern for you?
Well,
in the Philippines case?
Not for the Philippines, no. If you look at the global economy, what it looks like is that it's a normal business cycle. You know, the global economies, most of the industrial economies are slowing down at the same time. And it's probably due to a slowdown in their own domestic investment. And then there's other factors that accelerate that. Yes, that may accelerate that. And Brexit, for example, in the UK. But it's part of a normal business cycle that's occurring. What we've seen, how governments have reacted in the industrial countries, is to cut interest rates. And yes, in many countries, those interest rates are either close to zero or even below zero. Countries are also having a discussion about using fiscal policy to stimulate their economies, particularly given the global headwinds. So it's partly a normal business cycle, and governments are responding as you would expect. In the Philippines case, growth is still very high relative to the neighboring countries. Got a lot of fiscal space. Private consumption or household consumption is still strong, so we don't have those concerns. I think the main concern would be keep that growth above 6%. That's important for job generation and reducing poverty.
Okay, so let's talk about the infrastructure push, because ADB is actually one of the biggest sources of the Philippines ODA, Official Development Assistance. In fact, we were talking earlier, and I read your fact sheet. Annually, you used to, spend here in the Philippines, invest around $800 million, but you're saying you're scaling up. Talk to us about the scaling up.
Okay, as you mentioned, you know, from about 2011 to 2016, we lent to the Philippine government around $800 million annually. We have now scaled it up to $2.5 billion annually. So this year we should reach 2.5, and we are targeting $2.5 billion from 2020 to 2022. Okay. Why is that the case? It's primarily because the government has build. So it has a major infrastructure program. And as I've mentioned in the past, Philippines is greatly underinvested in infrastructure. And this build program is designed to catch up. That allows ADB to support the government in its build program. So that's allowed us to scale up. And in fact, 60% of our lending will be in infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. And at $2.5 billion per year spending here, would you say that the Philippines is one of your biggest beneficiaries for that? Where are we in the bigger scheme of things compared to other countries?
I think this year and next year it'll be among the largest three borrowers for ADB.
Mm-hmm. And are you happy with the way these infrastructure projects that you fund for the government are being carried out? Because they've been criticized for doing a terrible job because of the slow rollout. What do you think?
Okay, for me, I think the government's exceeded expectations. Mm-hmm. And if you look at public spending on infrastructure, it's been growing hugely in the last 3 or 4 years. You know, on average, I think it's about, you know, it's ranged from 10 to 30%. Mm-hmm. So it's been growing on average well over 15% per annum. So they have, and if you look around, you'll see a lot of the projects that started, they've been implemented and they've been completed. What's happening now is that those larger, more complex projects are about to get underway this year and next year. So we should see a wave of new projects coming out.
So this is
in the next couple of years.
Just impatience, high expectations.
I think everyone's impatient,
and that's good.
And that's good. I think it's healthy. I think it's virtuous.
Mm-hmm. And final question: we don't have much time. You have a lot of projects that you're funding in the pipeline. The biggest one so far is Malolos Clark Railway project. You're investing this year alone $1.3 billion. What's the timetable for that? Where are we in the process?
Okay, so we got that approved in May of this year. Mm-hmm. We did advanced procurement with the Department of Transportation. They are now evaluating those bids. We hope that they will award contracts by the end of this year, early next year. Mm-hmm. Could be contracts up to about $1.5 billion. Mm-hmm. You know from the Department of Transportation's own announcements, they've got a very good quality bidders. But we expect construction to commence around second quarter of next year. And for a major complex project like that, that's fast.
That's fast. You were saying that this was a plan that was in the books for how many years?
Well, I think I understand it was on the books for 20 years. And so when the government came in, they had to basically start from scratch. So they managed to prepare this project within 2 years. Typically, it would take 4 or 5 years to prepare, but they did do it in record breaking
time. That's not slow, not bad
at
all.
No, it's very fast.
On that note, thank you very much, Kelly, for joining us this morning.
Okay, thank you.
To watch more ANC videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the bell button for more updates. We'll be right back.